Welcome to Chem Help ASAP. So the SN1 and E1 reactions both start with a carbocation, and so it can sometimes make it hard to decide how is the reaction going to finish? What's the fate of my carbocation? So let's try to clarify that in this video. So both SN1 and E1 reactions, they have to form a carbocation. And the hardest part about making a carbocation is that the carbocation has to be stable. That means it should be tertiary, maybe perhaps secondary. Secondaries aren't great, or maybe resonance stabilization, but it needs to be a good carbocation. What is the difference between these two? Okay, in the SN1 reaction, if you have a nucleophile, and when I say nucleophile, I tend to think like SN2 nucleophiles, like sodium azide. Now in the SN1, we're talking about weak nucleophiles. Remember, our carbocation is a strong electrophile, so we want to match it with a weak nucleophile. If you have a weak nucleophile, you're going to do an SN1. If you don't have a nucleophile at all, then you're talking about an E1. So what would these look like? Here is a typical starting material. This is a nice highly substituted halide. It will form a nice highly substituted carbocation. The SN1 pathway might look more like a solvolysis. We could react this with methanol, polar product solvent, or ethanol, or water, one of these polar product solvents, and we would expect to get the SN1 product. We're having a stable carbocation and we have a weak nucleophile. We will get the SN1 product. If we're going to do an E1, we might not have anything on the arrow because there's no nucleophile present. All we might be given is heat. And if that's the case, we'll show our elimination product. So the reactions are very similar. They both start with a carbocation. It's what happens to that carbocation. Carbocations are either attacked, that gives us the SN1 product, or they lose a beta hydrogen, that gives us the E1 product.